I'm guessing this is the first time you've ever been at Ellis Park. Like, you just got here. Have you ever been here before?
I have not. I literally just pulled up. The plan was to move from California to Oaklawn Park and then, do Kentucky pretty much year round after that, besides the winter time. So we're pretty much full tilt all in. We just got done with Churchill Downs. It started off a little slow, but I was really pleased the way we ended there. And we'll be at Ellis pretty much all summer here. I know I'll be shipping around a little bit every now and then on weekends to ride a stake or two here and there, but for the most part we'll be here all meet. I love how big it is. They said, I haven't ridden or worked horses here, but they say it's a mile and an eighth and a mile turf course, which that's always cool to ride a bigger track. I know Hollywood Park was the same kind of dimensions like that, and horses tend to like it too. So I'm excited.
Yeah, it's the biggest racetrack in Kentucky, dirt track anyways. Kentucky Downs is a bigger turf course, but a lot of people don't realize that, and they don't realize it's the second oldest track, Ellis Park, in Kentucky.
I didn't know that either.
Churchill Downs.
See, I'm learning new stuff every time I'm here. No, but I'm excited, looking forward to a good meet. It's actually been a really easy transition, just because I mean even though I was in California for 13, 14 years, I mean I never lost sight of where I started from and where my roots were in Louisiana, because I mean that's really where I fell in love with horse racing, and that's where I it struck me that I wanted to be a jockey so bad. So it's funny coming back here to Oakland first and then Kentucky. It's kind of given me a little bit of a spark, so to say, because it kind of brought me back to my childhood and really when I really knew I wanted to be a jockey, kind of brought me back to that. You know, when I was about 7 or 8 years old, my dad was an assistant trainer for quite a number of years at the fairgrounds, and I grew up riding quarter horses. It was never thoroughbreds, and then I went out to the track with him. I had to be 7 or 8 years old, and obviously you look at a jockey and myself at the time I was riding horses, he coordinated the two. I'm like, man, I think I want to do that. I never did think anything more of it, but the more I started going to the track with my dad, it just sparked my interest, and I just fell in love with it. And really from the age of I'd say 7 or 8 years old, I mean that's all my mind was towards, is just working to try and be a jockey. And I never did really set forward any goals or anything. I just wanted to be able to ride. I've been very blessed to be around some really, really special people in my life that not have only made me successful being a jockey, but as a person as well. I think that's huge in anything. It's who you associate with. But again, over my career, I've just been very blessed to ride for some really good owners, trainers, and obviously with that comes good horses. So hopefully we can keep that going.
You went from one of the most established, best known agents in the game in Scotty McClellan to Jake Romans, who's Dale Roman's son, but he's fairly new on the scene as an agent. Young? You all are probably about the same age, I'm guessing. Close to
he's actually younger than me, which is crazy.
But how's that, going that switch from somebody that's been around?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Scotty, he still is like family to me. I mean, we were together, I forget how long, 13 years, something like that, or... I forget, honestly. I think 2008 or 2007 he got me, so we were together quite a long time. But I know he wanted to stay out in California, which I mean I can't blame him for that, but yeah, I got hooked up with Jake, and he's really done a tremendous job. I mean we had a really good Oakland meet, and even at Churchill when we started off pretty slow, I mean that's just kind of how things are. He was actually still able to get me on live horses day in and day out, which is saying something, because when you go when you go one for whatever I was, obviously it's horsemen and trainers and owners look for someone who's obviously winning a little bit more. So I was actually very impressed during that time that he was still able to get me on live horses and get into some good outfits, and things changed around, and we started winning at a really good clip the last 3-4 weeks there, so I was very impressed with that.
And that was a tough meet, a lot of full fields and a lot of price horses coming in, which is a function of the full fields, and it was, it could be, you could be one for a row for.
Oh, absolutely.
on nice horses.
Oh, absolutely. And especially it was so consolidated that first 2-3 weeks, just from every other track seemed to being closed down, you know. But I think what helped me through that too, believe me, that wasn't the first time I'd been through. I think I was one for 70 or 80 one meet at Santa Anita, and I ended up third leading rider. So I mean, that's just the ebbs and flows of the game. You just as you over the years, you just kind of get used to those things and just ride through them pretty much.
Now you are from Louisiana, which is famous for its riders, but there's sort of two camps. There's the Craig Perrette, the New Orleans riders, and then there's all the Cajun riders from the Lafayette area, like Burrell and Flannery and all them. So to set the record straight, you are from New Orleans. Are you Cajun also, in addition to being from New Orleans, or you are the non-Cajun?
I'm the Craig Perrette version. Yeah, I mean, I grew up right outside of New Orleans, so I'm not. I'm a little Cajun from just from blood. That's about it. But Talamo is actually Sicilian, so I'm kind of Sicilian Cajun. I don't know if that counts. kind of a funny mix there. But no, I grew up right outside of New Orleans. That's about two and a half hours from where all of the true Cajun riders are. So like I said, I'm just in Craig Perrette territory there, which, hey, if I could be affiliated with one guy, it would definitely be him. I mean, if you look at his career, if I could have anything close to that, I'd sign on to that in a heartbeat.
When you were growing up in New Orleans and probably went to the track quite a bit with your dad, who were the jockeys maybe that did you have role models?
Oh, man, Robbie Alvarado. I still have whips and goggles from him. I mean, he was the man there. And even Corey at the time was doing good. I would idolize those guys, you know. And I can remember as a kid, just right before I started, I could be like, man, I just want to ride with him. And then I rode with him. And then when you beat him one time, it's like, oh, man, I made it. But it's funny thinking back to those times.
How weird is it to ride in these places when there's no fans? I mean, we shot that first race, and I've been out here every year, and it's like, God dang, that was quiet.
Yeah, it's definitely taken some getting used to. I don't think any of us are really used to it. You know, it's definitely, if you told me everyone would be walking around with masks, and I'd be in the minority not doing, I would have thought you're crazy. But you know what, it's one of those things. We kind of have to do what we got to do to keep racing going. And I mean, you definitely love to see fans here, but I mean, for the safety and health of everyone, I think it's worked out pretty well given the circumstances.